إن الحمد لله نحمده ونستعينه ونستغفره ونستهديه ونعوذ بالله من شرور أنفسنا ومن سيئات أعمالنا، من يهده الله فلا مضل له ومن يضلل فلا هادي له، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدا عبده ورسوله صلى الله عليه وسلم. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. يا أيها الناس اتقوا ربكم الذي خلقكم من نفس واحدة وخلق منها زوجها وبث منهما رجالا كثيرا ونساء، واتقوا الله الذي تساءلون به والأرحام، إن الله كان عليكم رقيبا. يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله وقولوا قولا سديدا يصلح لكم أعمالكم ويغفر لكم ذنوبكم، ومن يطع الله ورسوله فقد فاز فوزا عظيما. إن أصدق الحديث كتاب الله وخير الهدي هدي محمد صلى الله عليه وسلم، وشر الأمور محدثاتها وكل محدثة بدعة وكل بدعة ضلالة وكل ضلالة في النار، أما بعد. As we all know, we are in the month of Muharram, in the beginning of a new Hijri year, 1438 years since the Hijra. Today, inshallah, I wanted to recount the story of the Hijra of the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Some of the lessons we can derive from lessons of the Hijra. We should know that the Hijra, or the migration of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, is one of the cornerstone events in Islamic history. It's one of the milestone, one of the landmarks in Islamic history. It was so important that Umar radiallahu an, when he decided to start the Islamic calendar in coordination with other companions, they decided to choose the dates in relation to the baseline of the Hijra. Why? Because of the importance of the Hijra. Even when we look at the books of Tafsir, we find that the chapters of the Quran, they're divided into Makki and Madani chapters in the Quran. So the Hijra is a defining period between the Makkan and the Medina period. Because the surahs, the Makki surahs, they are related to Aqidah and they are very distinct in style. While the Madani surahs, they're related more to legislation and to community building. So the Hijra is something which is very, very important, but is rarely spoken about. Many of us, we have followed this journey of the Hijra. When you go on Umrah or you go on the Hajj, we make the journey from Mecca to Medina, maybe by air, maybe by road, and it's a matter of only a few hours. However, have we ever thought about the Hijra of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? How was the Hijra when he made the Hijra? And was it just plain sailing, or was there more to it than that? The first thing we should know about the Hijra, brothers and sisters, and this is something which is really profound, is the amount of planning the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam he undertook before he undertook the Hijra. The Hijra was not a random mission. Suddenly he woke up in the morning and decided to abandon Mecca and travel to Medina. Rather, when you look at the planning, it's really amazing. Why was the planning required? The planning was required because the Quraysh, the tribe in Mecca, they were against the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam making the Hijra. Why was this? It's because they were worried that this newfound belief, this belief would challenge their polytheistic practices. Some of the Muslims, they had already made Hijra before the Hijra of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and he worried them that when the leader of this movement would join them in Medina, then this movement would take root. The movement would become very, very powerful. Not only this, but they feared that if the Muslims, they established a state in Medina, then this would block their trade caravans. So the Quraysh, it was in their interests to prevent the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam from making the Hijra, from establishing a safe haven in Medina. So they held a very, very important meeting in a place called Darun Nadwa, when all the leaders of the clans of Quraysh, they got together. And they said, enough is enough, that this Muhammad, he has made so much trouble. How will we put an end to this? So some of them, they suggested, let's imprison him. Others, they said, let's vanquish him, let's expel him from the land. And others yet again said the only solution is that we have to assassinate him. We have to kill him. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in Surah Al-Anfal, he refers briefly to this incident, this meeting in Darun Nadwa between the leaders of Quraysh. And Allah ta'ala says, وَإِذْ يَمْكُرُ بِكَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا لِيُثْبِتُوكَ أَوْ يَقْتُلُوكَ أَوْ يُخْرِجُوكَ وَيَمْكُرُونَ وَيَمْكُرُ اللَّهُ وَاللَّهُ خَيْرُ الْمَاكِرِينَ. That when the disbelievers, they gathered to imprison you, or to kill you, or to expel you. And they planned and they plotted. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he also planned and plotted. And Allah is the best one who plans and plots. So they planned and plotted to kill the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. This was the final decision, that we have to kill him. So the plan was that they would select one strong young man from each and every clan. And Quraysh, they were made up of many, many clans. The clan of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, this was Banu Hashim. Banu Hashim. However, there were other clans, and one member of each clan would come, and there would be a coordinated assault on the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and they would all kill the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam simultaneously. So this was the plan. However, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He knows better, and He informed the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam through revelation that the Quraysh, they have planned to kill you. Now is the time to make the move. So then the plan for the hijrah, it began. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he went to the house of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiyallahu anhu. And the narrator of the hadith is none other than Aisha radiyallahu anha. And she says that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to visit my father every single day, once in the evening and once in the morning. However, on this day, he came at midday. He came at midday when the streets, they were empty. So there was an air of secrecy about this meeting. And when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam arrived at the house of Abu Bakr, he exclaimed that what has happened? Something has happened, because it was unusual for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to visit him at that period of time. Then he made room for the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, who sat on his bed. The first thing the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said is that I want Aisha radiallahu anha and her sister Asma to leave the room. So Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he exclaimed that, no, these are my daughters, meaning you can trust them. If you have to tell me something secret, then your secret is with my daughters as well. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he permitted them to stay. Then the four of them, they sat in the room. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, I have been given permission by Allah jalla wa ala to migrate and to leave Makkah. And then Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu asked him directly that, will I be your companion in this migration, in this hijrah? And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, yes, you will be my companion. Aisha radiallahu anha, and she is the narrator of the hadith, she says that when Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu heard that he would be the one who was chosen to accompany the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he wept with happiness. And Aisha radiallahu anha, she says that never before did I think a man could cry out of happiness. It was the pinnacle of happiness when the tears, they become tears of joy. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu then presented the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam with two horses and said, I have prepared these two horses for this very day. And he offered the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam his horse, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, I don't take a horse for free, I will buy this horse. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he didn't want any freebies, rather he said he would pay his own way. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he was already aware that the hijrah, it would take place, because once he had said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when the Muslims, they face persecution, I want to make hijrah. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had stopped him and said that maybe Allah, He will give you a better companion. Maybe Allah, He will give you someone good to go with, so wait. And from that day onwards, Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, for 4 months, he was ready. He was ready 24/7 with two horses to make the hijrah, hoping that his companion would be the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, if you imagine the gravity of this incident, that he knew that if he was with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Quraysh caught them trying to escape, trying to flee from Mecca, then there would be certain death. They would kill him. However, it was more important to him that this religion, the religion of Tawheed, the religion of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, was preserved. And it was more important to him than self-preservation. So they hired a guide to show them the way in the desert, and they left the horses with the guide. And they said that when the time is right, then we will summon the guide to come with the horses. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as part of the planning, the next thing he did was he went to his cousin Ali radiallahu anhu. At that time, he was only a young man of about 10 years old. He said to Ali that, I want you to sleep in my bed tonight. I want you to cover yourself and sleep in my bed. Because you have to imagine that the Quraysh, they were watching every movement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. He was being monitored, he was under supervision. They wanted to see what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was doing. So he wanted to leave Ali radiallahu anhu as some kind of decoy to give him a head start in his escape to Medina. So this was a great sacrifice by Ali radiallahu anhu, similar to Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. He risked his life that if the men had entered the room and they had not lifted the covers, then he would be killed. There was a second reason why he left Ali radiallahu anhu behind in Medina. And the reason was that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was known as Al-Amin, the trustworthy. And the Quraysh, even though they belied him, even though they accused him of insanity, and of so many other things, that whenever they had something which was expensive, they would always leave it with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam as a trust. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, even during this stressful and panic-stricken state, he even had the presence of mind to say to Ali radiallahu anhu, that when I am gone, make sure you return the trust. That whatever has been entrusted to me, make sure you give it back to the rightful owners. So this shows the character of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, whether they were Muslim or non-Muslim. He made no distinction in the honor, in the matter of honesty and returning the trust. So then the day of departure came, and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam left Ali radiallahu anhu in bed, and he rendezvoused with Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu under the cover of darkness at the house of Abu Bakr, and they left through a small exit at the rear of the house. And as they left Mecca, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, in an emotional statement, he turned round and he looked at Mecca. Of course, Mecca in those days, it looked very different to the way Mecca looks now. And he said the famous words, "You are indeed the best of Allah's lands and the most beloved of Allah's lands to Allah. Had I not been expelled from you, I never would have left you." So he felt this great longing that the place of his birth, he would now have to abandon this place, even though he deeply loved this place where he worshipped Allah Jalla wa Ala besides the Kaaba al-Musharrafa. So then where did the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam go? Did he go straight to Medina? No, he did not go straight to Medina, because this would have been too obvious. So rather, he headed south. Medina is north of Mecca. Instead, they headed south to the outskirts of Mecca, and they went to a mountain called Thawr, and a cave within this mountain. So they went to this mountain on foot, and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu an and the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, they hid inside this cave, knowing full well that when Quraysh discovered they had escaped, they would send out the search party. So they decided to hide in a non-obvious location. So then the Quraysh, they went to the house of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and who did they find in the bed? They found none other than Ali radiallahu anhu, and they did not kill him. Rather, they were shocked to find that he was there. So then they sent the search parties in every direction. They were desperate to catch the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu. Eventually, one search party arrived at the cave of the Mount Thawr, and they came very, very close to the mouth of the cave. And when they passed by the mouth of the cave, they saw, and many of you will know the story, they saw a spider's web that had been woven on the mouth of the cave. And they said that a spider would not weave a spider's web on the mouth of the cave if there was someone within. So we won't go inside this cave to search this cave. So they left the cave, and Allah Jalla wa Ala, just imagine this, how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if he wants to protect someone, he can use anything. He can use something very big, he can use something very small. On this occasion, Allah Jalla wa Ala, he used a spider to protect the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. He inspired the spider to weave this web at the mouth of the cave, and in this way they were short. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu an, when he saw the shoes of the search party from Quraysh, he became very, very worried. And later he said that I said to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, if one of them were to look at his shoes, he would see us. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had said to him, "O Abu Bakr, that there is no problem. If we are two and Allah is the third in this gathering, then there is nothing to fear." And then this ayah from the Quran, it was revealed, "Illa tansuruhu faqad nasarahu Allah idh akhrajahu alladhina kafaru thani athnain idh huma fil ghar idh yaqulu li sahibihi la tahzan inna Allaha ma'ana fa'anzala Allahu sakinatahu wa ayyadahu bi junudin lam tarawha وَجَعْلَ كَلِمَةَ الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا السُّفْلَى وَكَلِمَةُ اللَّهِ هِيَ الْعُلْيَى وَاللَّهُ عَزِيزٌ حَكِيمٌ" So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in these ayat, he tells us that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam told Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, "La tahzan," that don't grieve, don't be sad. Allah jalla wa ala, he will look after us. And how Allah, he sent down his tranquility and his support in ways they could not imagine. And he made the word of the Muslims supreme and the word of the disbelievers lowly. So here, brothers and sisters, we see how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protected the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam from being discovered during this mission of the hijrah. Wa sallallahu wa sallam ala nabiyyina Muhammad wa ala alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على رسول الكريم ما بعد. We have left the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم and Abu Bakr as-Siddiq رضي الله عنه inside the cave of Athawr. So what happened next? What happened next was that the guide, he came. And even before we get to the guide, we have to reflect upon the pivotal role of the family of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anh in this mission. The Aisha radiallahu anha and her sister Asma, they were responsible for preparing the food. And Asma radiallahu anha, the sister of Aisha, she wanted to tie the bag of food, so she took off her waist wrapper and she used this. And from there onwards, she became known as the one with two waist wrappers. So they were very important in this mission, in preparing the food, the logistical support. Not only this, but the son of Abu Bakr radiallahu anhu, Abdullah, he would go and mix with the Quraysh and listen to what they were saying and then relay this information to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam. Even the servant of Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he would bring the milk every night. So they sat in this cave for 3 nights waiting. And then finally, the guide, he came with the horses, and they mounted the horses and they fled towards the direction of Medina. And the guide, he selected paths which were unknown to the people to make their detection more difficult. So this was a very, very arduous journey. It was not like traveling on a Saudi Airlines flight or getting a bus. Rather, it was a very, very difficult journey. If you've ever examined the terrain from air, you've seen how mountainous the terrain is, how barren the desert is between Mecca and Medina. You can imagine how difficult this journey must have been. Then they passed by a tent of a Bedouin on the way to Medina. And there was a woman who was sitting outside the tent. And her name was Ma'bad. Ma'bad. And Ma'bad, she had a small sheep, a very, very weak sheep. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, he asked that, can we buy some dates or can we buy some meat or some kind of provision for the journey? Ma'bad said, we don't have anything to offer you. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, what about that sheep? And she said, the sheep is weak, the sheep has nothing. The sheep has nothing to offer you. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, can I milk the sheep? So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he went to the sheep and he touched the udder of the sheep, and the sheep, even though it was very frail and weak, it started to produce milk. And they all drank from the milk until everyone's thirst had been quenched. And then the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam asked Ma'bad to bring forth some containers, and he filled the containers with milk. Then they left. After a while, Abu Ma'bad, the husband of Ma'bad, he arrived. And he said, where is this milk from? So she explained, we saw a small group of people, they came, and one of them, he touched the udder of this sheep, and he produced milk. So then she described the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and said, he was the most handsome man I have ever seen. And his face, it was glowing. He was not tall, nor was he short. He spoke very simple words, and he was not stern, and his followers, they loved him, because with the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was not only Abu Bakr, also the servant of Abu Bakr and the guide. So they said they loved him so much and they listened to him, and he was not stern with them, and he was very, very well mannered with them. So then Abu Ma'bad, he said that this is the man that Quraysh, they are searching for. And he said, if I had known about this man, then I would have become one of his followers. So he said, I will find this man and I want to follow him from the description you have given me. So then they continued their journey towards Medina. And the second incident, which is always mentioned in the books of Sirah, is the incident of Suraqa ibn Malik. Suraqa ibn Malik. And Suraqa ibn Malik, he was a crafty individual and he was in Mecca. And one of the Meccans said, we have received a report of a small group heading towards Medina. And I believe this could be the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So Suraqa, he said, no, it's impossible. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would never take this road. However, he wanted to deceive them. And he himself thought that I will go and get them. And there was a bounty on their heads of 100 camels. 100 camels must have been a huge amount of wealth. So Suraqa thought that this is a real lead. I will follow this lead and I will capture them. And then I will receive 100 camels. So he then set off on a fast horse and he chased the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu, all the time he was looking behind him. He was worried that maybe somebody would catch up with them. How the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, en route, all he did was read Quran. He was sitting on his horse just reciting the Quran. Eventually Suraqa, he caught up with the party of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. However, the horse, it bolted And Suraqa, he fell off the horse. He thought, this is very strange. Why have I fallen off the horse? Then he mounted the horse again, and the horse, it moved forward. And a second time he fell off the horse. And a third time he fell off the horse. Then he thought that this really must be a prophet of Allah. And Allah, Jalla wa Ala, he's protecting the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So he went to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and begged him that, please do something such that this doesn't happen. Every time I ride the horse throws me off. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, only thing we want is we want you to leave us. To leave us alone and don't tell anybody about our location. The Suraqa, he wanted an assurance. So he said, write me a letter. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam ordered a letter be written that they would not harm Suraqa ibn Malik. The Suraqa, he was about to leave when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam turned round to him and said to him that one day you will wear the bracelets of Kisra. Who was Kisra? Kisra was the ruler of Persia. You can imagine it was one of the major superpowers of the time. And the bracelets of Kisra, they were like the crown jewels. So imagine this kind of bizarre scenario where this man has come to kill the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, capture him. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam has given him an assurance that if you go, then you will not be harmed. And finally, the final word from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he said, one day you will wear the bracelets of Kisra. So then Suraqa, he left and he did not tell anybody about the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. As for the bracelets of Kisra, what happened to the bracelets of Kisra is that Suraqa, he became a Muslim. And in the time of Umar radiallahu anhu, in the Khilafah of Umar radiallahu anhu, the Muslims, they conquered Persia. And then all the wealth of Kisra, it was brought to Umar radiallahu anhu. And Umar, he found the bracelets of Kisra and he called Suraqa ibn Malik, that come here. He said, I want you to wear these bracelets. So just like the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam had foretold many decades before, Suraqa, he ended up wearing the bracelets of Kisra. So this is a beautiful story in the seerah of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. So eventually they arrived in Medina, and the Muslims in Medina, the ones who had already migrated, they were overjoyed to see the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, as were the Ansar, the native people of Medina, and they were really happy. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, the first thing he did was he went to a place called Quba. Quba, and many of you may have been to Masjid Quba, which is the first masjid in Islam. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam prayed there, and this is one of the special masjids in Islam, and you can go and pray two raka'ah there when you go to Medina, mashallah, and the reward is the reward of an umrah. So this is the way the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made this blessed hijrah, and in this way Allah jalla wa ala, he saved the message of Islam, which was the last and final message. What are the main lessons we can learn here? There are many, many lessons we can learn here. I just wanted to reflect upon just two or three. The first lesson we can learn, brothers and sisters, is that Muslims should be organized in everything they do. They should be planning in everything we do. You can see that because we don't plan, then we become fodder for the enemies of Islam. It's very, very important that we teach our children, just in our everyday life, to plan and try to do things in the best way. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when you look at the hijrah, you see a manual of management in planning. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, what did he do? He visited Abu Bakr during the day when it was very, very hot and no one can see him. He asked Abu Bakr to expel his daughters such that nobody else would listen. He left from the back door of the house of Ali radiallahu anhu. He placed Ali in his bed. He chose the correct number of people to travel with him such that they would not attract suspicion of anyone. So we can see here, brothers and sisters, that there are many, many lessons in planning here. It was not a random mission. It was a mission founded on theory, founded on a strong strategy. Also, we see, brothers and sisters, the importance of tawakkul and the importance of doing something. Like getting off your bottom and actually doing something. Many people, they make dua and nothing happens because they don't do anything. We have to, and this is the correct meaning of tawakkul, that you go ahead and you do as many actions as you can. You take every step, everything you can, at the same time your heart is connected to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he was a man of action. He was a man of proactivity. He was not someone who sat down and was served by the people. Rather, he was someone who was there to serve the people. So the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he made dua and he had tawakkul, but at the same time, he was very, very active in his life. Finally, I wanted to mention the great role of women in the hijrah. The women, they played a support role in the hijrah, but their role in the hijrah were nevertheless very, very important. We see the role of Aisha radiallahu anha and Asma radiallahu anha in preparing the provision of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It is said that Abu Jahl, one of the enemies of Islam, he came looking for Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anha after they had left, and he came to the house of Abu Bakr, and he asked Asma, where is Abu Bakr? And Asma said, I don't know where he is. So he slapped her. So we can see the sacrifice made by the women in the journey of the Hijrah. And in fact, they stayed behind in the lion's den while the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he had left with Abu Bakr in this advance party. Finally, we see the great love of the companions of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, and the respect from the description of Ma'bad, and also how the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he allowed the most oppressed of the companions to make the hijrah before he himself made the hijrah and joined them. So he was a leader in every sense. And we ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to make us his true followers, and for us to derive lessons from the hijrah, and to drink from the hand of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam on yawm al-qiyamah at the pool of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. جزاكم الله خيرا وصلى الله وسلم على نبينا محمد وعلى اله وصحبه وسلم واقم الصلاه. الله اكبر الله